It's a real pleasure to welcome Dr. Lael Brainard to CSIS. I've had a chance to work with her for many years. She's currently a member of the Federal Reserve, and she serves a term that ends in the year 2026. Now, by that stage, she will be 47, so she'll have a full career in front of her. I mean, that's not an issue. But this is one of the most unusual institutions where you serve for a long period of time doing work that everybody depends on and nobody knows anything about. I mean, this is part of what we're going to fix today. This is a rare opportunity for us to have a discussion with someone who is on the Fed board and inside of this very important institution, helping us think through what it means for all of us in our lives. And we're delighted that Dr. Brainard is with us. As I said, I first had a chance to meet her when she was the assistant to the president in the Clinton administration and the deputy director of the National Economic Council. Since that time, she went off. She was at Brookings for a time and then went into the administration, first as counselor to the Secretary of Treasury, and then became the Undersecretary for Treasury. And this is one of the very interesting things is how these two very different institutions that work so closely, and how do they work together between the Federal Reserve and the Department of Treasury. And I think we're going to find this to be a very, very interesting morning. And so I'm very, very grateful to have her here. I'm glad to have all of you here. And can I ask you now with your warm applause to welcome Dr. Lael Brainard. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank John for those very kind remarks. It is a huge pleasure for me to be back here at CSIS. I've had a lot of opportunities to collaborate with colleagues here at CSIS over the years, and it's always a real pleasure to be here. This spring marks the end of the Federal Reserve's calendar-based forward guidance and the return to full data dependency in the setting of the federal funds rate. So it's notable that just as policymaking is becoming more anchored in meeting-by-meeting assessments of the data picture is decidedly mixed. No doubt, bad weather, port disruptions, and statistical issues are responsible for some of the dismal first quarter GDP estimate. But there may be reasons not to dismiss the recent soft readings entirely. First, the limited data in hand pertaining to the second quarter do not suggest a significant bounce back yet. And second, it wouldn't be the first time. The underlying momentum of our recovery has proven susceptible to headwinds, which has kept economic growth well below the average of previous upturns. My own reading is that earlier, more optimistic growth projections may have placed too much weight on the boost to spending from lower energy prices and too little weight on the negative implications for aggregate demand of the significant increase in the foreign exchange value of the dollar and the decline in the price of crude oil. At a time when a lot of the growth burden is riding on U.S. consumers, they appear to be disinclined to spend much of the gains from cheaper prices at the pump, preferring, it seems, to strengthen household balance sheets instead. Relative to expectations predicated on that boost to real income from lower gas prices, consumer spending so far this year has been undeniably weak, especially given a backdrop of improving labor market prospects, solid consumer sentiment, and improving credit. Consumer spending is reported to have increased at an annual rate of only 1.8% in the first quarter, far below the 5.3% increase in household real disposable income. And data through April do not suggest a large bounce back. Continuing softness in consumption this year would naturally raise some questions about whether there's a more persistent change of foot, in particular, whether the financial crisis may have caused consumers to be more cautious about spending gains in income and wealth that are perceived to be temporary. Modest growth in consumer spending matters because strength in other categories of aggregate demand remains elusive. Certainly, the public sector is not likely to contribute significantly to GDP growth over the next few years, and although the data on housing starts and permits from April looks promising, average growth in residential investment over the past year and a half has been tepid. It's puzzling that housing starts have remained so far below trend levels implied by population growth, given low interest rates and continued job gains. Tight credit for borrowers with less than pristine credit histories may explain some of the weakness, but it's possible that attitudes towards home ownership have changed as a result of the financial crisis, especially among the millennial Great Recession generation. Just as the positive effects appear to have been more muted, so too the negative effects from the substantial decline in the price of oil and appreciation of the exchange rate on business investment, manufacturing, and exports seems to have been greater than expected. Drilling activity, for instance, is reported to have fallen at an annual rate of 50% in the first quarter, and data suggest another large decline this quarter. The dollar's rise is reducing net exports and may be restraining investment in areas sensitive to foreign demand with greater force than anticipated. Net exports subtracted 1 percentage point from GDP in the fourth quarter of last year and a whopping 1.9 percentage point in the first quarter. Business equipment spending and business sentiment have also been weak, suggesting that overall business investment could change little over the first half of the year. Foreign headwinds also appear to be affecting manufacturing activity. Manufacturing production declined at an annual rate of 1% in the first quarter, and the ISM National Manufacturing Diffusion Index of new export orders has been in contractionary or neutral territory for 4 of the past 5 months. Of course, there is a danger in reading too much into this data. The ISM's non-manufacturing index suggests that activities remain solid in the private services sector, which of course accounts for the bulk of economic activity. So in assessing whether a stronger trend in domestic economic activity will soon reassert itself, I think it's important to keep in mind the international context. And here, one thing is clear. The notable effects of recent cross currents from abroad should lay to rest any remaining lore that the United States is a closed economy. Financial linkages between the United States and foreign economies are immediate and extensive. Equity prices, long-term interest rates and risk spreads, and exchange rates show strong reactions to developments abroad. And in recent months, foreign developments have at times been the dominant factor driving U.S. financial conditions. Weak foreign aggregate demand accompanying accommodative monetary policies in the euro area and Japan and diverging expectations have been key among the factors causing a significant 10% appreciation of the dollar since last June. To the extent that exchange rate appreciation exerts a tightening force on financial conditions in the United States, it delays the return of U.S. interest rates to more normal levels. And while trade is a smaller share of the U.S. economy than in many other economies, exchange rate changes of the magnitude seen recently can have large effects on aggregate demand. We've seen a large negative contribution of net exports in the past 2 quarters, and some models estimate that the effect of exchange rates on net exports can last up to 3 years. Even before the latest estimate of the first quarter drag from net exports, many private sector forecasters expected net exports to subtract materially from GDP growth this year and next. Foreign headwinds also appear to be affecting U.S. inflation. Weak foreign demand appears to be the dominant factor driving recent reductions in the prices of non-oil commodities, and the stronger dollar is weighing on U.S. inflation through lower import prices more generally. Non-oil import prices are reported to have declined at an annual rate of 4.5% last quarter, and April data suggest a decrease of a similar magnitude this quarter. Some models imply that falling import prices might subtract about 0.33 percentage point from consumer price inflation this year. Recently, the euro area has seen some encouraging data. Nonetheless, there remain risks that could prolong or intensify foreign headwinds going forward. Most immediately, negotiations between Greece and its creditors are challenging, and the risk of further deterioration cannot be ruled out. While the euro area has broadened its policy toolkit and member states have made significant strides in building their resilience, the recovery is still fragile in several member states and vulnerabilities remain. In addition, Chinese GDP growth looks to have slowed noticeably, and there's some risk of further slowing. This reflects in part a significant correction in the property market and the shadow banking sector, but structural factors are also at work. Potential output growth in China is expected to slow, in part because of challenging demographics and the transition from heavy reliance on exports and investment toward household demand. Starting this month, with the end of calendar-based forward guidance, the decisions of the Federal Open Market Committee, the FOMC, regarding the federal funds rate will depend on the evolution of incoming economic data. While the date of liftoff will not be predetermined, the conditions governing the decision to lift off have been clearly stated. First, to have reasonable confidence that inflation will be on track to reach its target of 2% over the medium term, I will be looking closely at signs that core inflation is firming, deflationary pressures from abroad are abating, and measures of inflation expectations are stable. Recent data have provided some reassurance that U.S. inflation is starting to firm. Oil prices have retraced part of their earlier decline, and monthly changes in core PCE prices have increased from the very low levels around the turn of the year. Even so, most indicators of the underlying trend in PCE inflation are around 1.25% to 1.5%, noticeably below the FOMC's 2% target. It's reassuring that survey-based measures of longer-run inflation expectations appear to have remained stable. In addition, market-based measures of inflation expectations have moved up somewhat in the past few months after several months of decreases. Second, I'll also want to see solid further employment growth and further evidence of a reduction in labor market slack based on a variety of indicators. The robust pace of labor market improvement was perhaps the brightest part of the data picture over 2014. As we've advanced into 2015, the pace of job gains has slowed. Even so, job gains appear to be consistent with declining labor market slack, as are indicators such as unemployment insurance claims and job openings. My judgment is that there is still room for employment and hours worked to grow, as labor market indicators suggest slack not captured by the overall unemployment rate. In particular, labor force participation still remains low relative to its declining pre-crisis trend, and the number of employees who are working less than they would like is still elevated. Moreover, measures of wage growth remain soft and haven't significantly strengthened over the past year, providing evidence of remaining slack. Although the overall unemployment rate is near levels commonly associated with the natural rate, that natural rate may actually have declined over the past few years, such that a gap remains between the unemployment rate and its natural rate. The composition of the labor force looks to be shifting toward groups with relatively low levels of unemployment. A reduction in workers' bargaining power or reduced levels of labor market churning may also be putting downward pressure on the natural rate. With the labor market evidencing additional slack not well captured by the standard unemployment rate, and with inflation soft relative to its target, there may be room to support further healing in the labor market, which is appropriate following the deep damage from the Great Recession. On net, then, there is value to watchful waiting, while additional data help clarify the economy's underlying momentum in the face of headwinds from abroad. If the labor market strengthens further and inflation readings continue to improve, liftoff could come before the end of the year. Of course, the date of liftoff is only one in a series of decisions the FOMC will be making in response to incoming data. Just as no previous recovery has proceeded as this one has, so too, there is no reason to expect monetary policy to follow previous tightening cycles. Given the unique conditions in the labor market and the economy more broadly, I will want to move step by step observing how the markets and the economy respond before gauging the appropriate next step in the policy path. The divergence in conditions here and abroad injects an important element of uncertainty with regard to the path of policy. While the dollar's appreciation is generally transmitted into somewhat tighter financial conditions, the advent of quantitative easing in Europe appeared to have led to some compression in term premiums, not only in European bond markets, but also in the United States. Although longer-dated yields have recently moved somewhat higher, it's difficult to know in advance how term premiums will respond when U.S. normalization gets underway. To the extent that the commencement of normalization leads to relatively greater demand for U.S. assets, we could see echoes of the so-called conundrum of 2004 to 2005, when rising short-term rates were accompanied by falling forward rates. But the reverse is also possible, with term premiums moving more steeply than appropriate for underlying economic conditions, which we saw in the so-called taper tantrum in 2013. Certainly, my colleagues and I are mindful of recent episodes which have seen unusually sharp spikes in market volatility. Accordingly, I expect the FOMC will continue proceeding to the greatest extent possible in a very deliberate manner, aiming to provide clear communications about the economic and policy outlook. Based on today's picture of moderate underlying momentum at home and cross currents from abroad, the process of normalizing monetary policy is likely to be gradual. The stance of monetary policy will remain highly accommodative even after the federal funds rate moves off the effective lower bound because of the elevated size of the Federal Reserve's balance sheet and the associated downward pressure on long-term rates, as well as initially low real federal funds rate. Moreover, the FOMC has made clear that it will reduce the size of the balance sheet in a gradual and predictable manner, starting at an appropriate time after liftoff, which will depend on the evolution of economic and financial conditions. To wrap up, while it's possible that residual seasonality and temporary factors are to blame for the recent string of soft data, it is difficult to dismiss the possibility of a more significant drag on the economy than anticipated from the exchange rate and the negative effects of the oil price decline, along with a more cautious U.S. consumer. This argues for giving the data some more time to confirm further improvements in the labor market and firming of inflation towards our 2% target. But while the case for liftoff may not be immediate, it is coming into clearer view. When that time comes, the policy path will be highly attuned to incoming data and not on a preset course. It's important to be mindful of the possibility of volatility when markets do adjust to the change in the stance of policy. So the FOMC will continue communicating as clearly as possible regarding the outlook and the factors underlying its policy determination. Thank you.
Well, can I put you on this one? I think it'll be easier so the audience can see you if you're over here, and I'll get out of the way a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm so proud of myself. I understood 100% of those words and 40% of what they meant, you know? I'm so proud. I mean, this is really good. So I'm going to struggle to try to ask a few intelligent questions, and then I'm counting on the audience to really help me with that. But let me begin. I just took some little notes as we were going along. You know, you said that normalization is likely to be gradual. Let me ask, now I realize there's a limit to what you can say maybe about this, but you and your colleagues on the Fed, are you guys all over the map and therefore your consensus reflects a lowest common denominator, or do you have a strong consensus about what's happening and a policy consensus and therefore that's what informs it? Is it a positive consensus or a negative consensus that informs the board?
So the FOMC speaks through its statements with one voice, and then of course you see the members of the FOMC clarifying their own views in their own comments outside of that context. But I think what you can see from the statement that came out of the last FOMC meeting, and in fact the evolution of statements, that there is a pretty clear set of guidelines about what the committee overall is looking for as we prepare to normalize monetary policy. And in particular, there's been emphasis put on further strengthening of the labor market and reasonable confidence that inflation is moving towards our 2% target over the medium term. And then I think what you'll see is that individual members have given some context about what they will be looking at in particular for those two conditions to be met.
You had a term that you used in your speech where you said watchful waiting will be kind of the byword for this. What then would be the kind of important leading indicators that you would be watching for? What gives you a sense of things really important that in your mind give you direction?
So there's a set of data really that we will be looking at, and I will in particular be looking at over coming weeks and months. As I was describing earlier, to get confident that the labor market is getting closer to full employment per our mandate, our dual mandate that's given to us by law, it's no longer sufficient simply to look at the aggregate unemployment rate, because obviously the Great Recession and the financial crisis that preceded it have changed some of the relationships in the labor market. And as a result, it is possible that the aggregate unemployment rate is not capturing fully the dimensions of slack. So I think it's important to look at wage growth. I think it's important to look at the number of workers who are working part-time but would prefer to be working more. It's also important to be looking at the labor force participation rate. That gives us a much richer picture of the amount of remaining slack in the labor market. And you know, as you know, we really haven't seen the kind of firming of wages that would suggest that that slack is really narrow in the labor market. The second set of indicators pertain to inflation. And obviously, our inflation target is a forward-looking target. But there, too, in order to get a sense of whether inflation is giving us reasonable confidence that it's moving towards the 2% target over the medium term, I am also looking at a variety of indicators, both underlying trend in PCE inflation today, but also measures of inflation expectations from the markets, from surveys, and recognizing that some factors like the oil price decline were transitory, and really, you know, we can look through some elements of inflation, but we're really trying to gauge that underlying trend.
Mm-hmm. Let me hover over this issue and the answer you gave, where you said that obviously looking at the quality of wages becomes an important thing that you will look at. There's a bigger debate going on in Washington now about the fairness of compensation, labor, returns to labor, returns to equity. Does that enter in any way into your deliberations when you are meeting and thinking through these things?
Well, certainly, as I'm thinking about the robustness of the recovery, the distribution of income enters into an assessment of the health of the recovery. In particular, you know, we have seen income trends over a period that really predates the recession that are leading to a greater concentration of income and wealth at a very much smaller part of the population income distribution. And the concern over time, apart from fairness, which of course is also a very important concern, but from an economic robustness point of view, is whether consumers at the middle and lower end who are not getting those income gains to the extent they might have 20, 30 years ago are feeling secure enough about their futures and their children's futures to invest, to invest in housing, to consume. And so there is a very important link between the distribution of income and the robustness of economic growth that I think we do worry about, or I worry about, certainly.
There are really kind of two sets of political voices on this question of normalization. You get one group that says, look, we needed to be aggressive to replace the collapse of aggregate demand to avoid it getting worse, and therefore active intervention, monetary policy, fiscal policy was needed to put a foundation under demand. And then you get those that argue that quantitative easing is a narcotic. We're hooked. We can't get rid of it. We look at Japan, 20 years of stumbling through a recovery, four different times when they've tried to reverse and sent back. I mean, how does that debate figure with you guys?
So obviously, it's very important for me that I look at all of the research that's been done in this arena, and also the evidence that we're gauging every day. My reading of the research is it's a strong endorsement of the highly accommodative monetary policies that were undertaken over the last several years. If you do a compare and contrast between this Great Recession and the Depression, for instance, you can see that a very activist and accommodative monetary policy made a material difference in the course of both the recession and the subsequent recovery. Now, the channels through which it worked in the United States, I think, are pretty evident from the research that we saw a material boost to the housing market. We saw a material boost to investment and economic activity from the reduction in longer-term rates. It's very hard for me to see the case. The real question would be, what would the alternative have been? How would one have seen the recovery proceeding? And I think, that's where the critique really falls short, because it's not clear that those who criticize QE, and of course every policy has some risks, have a really good alternative to propose. Certainly not an alternative that I have seen that would have been effective under the very severe conditions that we saw.
Can I get just again to on this point? If you earlier said that soft wage increases in the labor market become a factor that holds back normalization, but American labor, because of today's technology, competes against Chinese labor and Indian labor around the world in certain ways. It looks like we're seeing a slack coming in China. It looks like we are seeing a prolonged slack in Europe. So American workers, in some sense, have their wages depressed by the slump or the slackness in these other places. How does that figure in? Because you're not operating just with an autonomous American economy now. We've got these behaviors in other countries that are affecting.
Yeah, so I think generally speaking, we have this kind of very outdated notion that the U.S. economy is a closed economy. And I think if we've learned anything, if we've seen anything over the last few quarters and previously, it is that the U.S. Is very highly integrated into international markets on all dimensions. And yes, we do experience cross currents from abroad, and they do affect our recovery. And of course, they also affect the policy response. As our recovery is buffeted by headwinds from abroad, that affects our policy response here at home. So we certainly have seen that net exports have been a big drag. That means that manufacturing is weaker than it would otherwise be, and of course that does transmit into the labor market. And similarly, we've seen that prices are being, import prices are being affected by deflationary pressures from abroad, and that affects our underlying rate of inflation. So these headwinds from China, from Europe, from Japan, from a weaker global economy really do materially affect the pace of our recovery, and they affect the pace at which labor market slack is being taken up here in our economy as well.
So we have a slack labor market in maybe in China and in Europe. At the time in the fall when perhaps you want to start more normalization, which would mean higher interest rates, how does this happen without it cycling back to create the problem again? Because interest rates would come up, capital would flow in. What would happen here? Wouldn't it reinforce the negatives in this situation?
Yeah, so as I was sketching out earlier, certainly when you have divergent expectations of growth in the U.S. relative to our foreign trade partners, accompanied by expectations of divergences in the monetary policy or interest rates abroad versus the U.S., that will cycle back into financial conditions in the U.S. It cycles back through asset prices, through the exchange rate, and as a result, it actually does affect the pace of normalization here in the U.S. Monetary policy endogenously tends to respond to a tightening of financial conditions here in the U.S. that may be coming from abroad.
Do you think Greece leaves the EU or the euro, I should say?
So I know that European leaders and policymakers are very engaged on negotiations with the Greek leadership and policymakers. I think there is clearly a path for the Greece to regain more resilience financially, for Greece to remain within the euro area and for the euro area as a whole to grow together. But of course, negotiations are ongoing as we speak. And so, you know, we'll have to see how those proceed, but there certainly is an ability for all sides to come together around a path that has Greece remaining in the euro area and the euro area growing as a whole.
I think you've articulated what we all hope is the case and we want to be the case, but if we just crash up against the wall here, what happens, forgive me for saying it, what happens to us? I mean, you know, what happens if we see this tremor in the euro, and how does it echo over here?
So European policymakers have built out their policy toolkit. The euro area as a whole is more resilient than it was 2 years ago, 3 years ago. But of course, you know, we always have to be attendant to risks, whether they emanate from abroad or domestically. And again, our financial markets are very tightly integrated with European financial markets. So I think we are very attentive to the possibilities of volatility. You know, again, there is a path here, and our hope is that is the path that the leaders choose to take over the next days, weeks, and months.
Well, I've used my privilege being the here, but I'll turn to you just one last question, if I may. I think it was last weekend that Germany hosted the finance ministers for the G7, and I think there's a G7 meeting coming up. I realize there's a limit to what you can say, but do you have any insights into what we might be anticipating at this meeting?
You know, I really don't any longer have the ability to speak at all for the administration's position in those kinds of negotiating fora. I will say that there's a really important growth agenda from my narrow perspective sitting at the Fed that all of the members of the G7 really could come together and make a material difference. In particular, I think there's a case for more aggregate demand strengthening coming from inside the euro area using a broader set of tools that go beyond the monetary policy toolkit. And you know, we've seen some of the surplus economies in the euro area really have capacity to provide more of the aggregate demand, and I'd like to see
so
that.
So the austerity agenda should abate?
So I would like to see more aggregate demand coming from some of the
Isn't
surplus economies.
Isn't she good? That's so impressive. I'm unbelievable how she avoids this tough problem. But thank you. Okay, let me open this up for colleagues. You've got some questions over here. We're going to write a microphone. We'll come right down here first.
Thank you. Katerina Sokol with Greek Daily Kathimerini. If I may follow up on the Greek question, you were instrumental in the past in the U.S. handling of the Greek crisis. And I'm wondering, from your experience, how much leverage does the U.S. have in influencing these ongoing negotiations, you know, between Greece and its creditors? And if you may just please also say, would the Greek default influence the Fed's monetary policy? Thank you.
So, you know, the U.S. obviously has a very important diplomatic interest, strategic interest in the relationship with Greece and in Greece remaining in the euro area, as well as, of course, economic interests. These are decisions for members of the euro area largely to make for Greece and other members of the euro area to make. But the U.S. Has a role to play, has a big interest in a good outcome. And so I think on the margins, you know, having the U.S. Treasury Secretary, the U.S. President, continuing to stay very engaged in those conversations has been very constructive, and they can continue to play a constructive role with the recognition that at the end of the day, these are decisions for Greece and for other members of the euro area. And again, just to return to the remarks I made earlier, you know, we do here in the U.S., economic policymakers in the U.S. have an interest in the kind of ongoing resilience of the recovery in the euro area. And so Greece navigating this path forward along with other members of the euro area in a way that's good for the euro area, good for Greece, is actually also highly in our interest and does affect policy considerations here in the United States.
Yes, ma'am. This right down here, the third row in the pink jacket. Thank you.
Thank you, Esther Zhou Yun with China Central TV, CCTV. So we learned from the news last week that Chair Yellen will not participate in this year's Jackson Hole meeting. This is kind of rare in the history of this symposium. So I just wonder, and now the speculation just go on. And some say it's because maybe September is the time and there's some other guesses. So I just wonder, is there any special thoughts or considerations behind this, or just as simple as a like a schedule issue, or is the Federal Reserve wants to keep low-key before any possible moves that might happen later this year? Thank you.
So let me just say that you know, I really can't speak for Chair Yellen's schedule at all. I can say there are a lot of conferences that the Reserve Banks, all of the Reserve Banks, hold all year round, and you know, attendance at a particular conference for any member of the board or any of the presidents, you know, is a personal decision based on scheduling considerations.
Right down here in the front, the second row, please. Thank you.
Richard Goodstein, CSS, class of 74. Question about the labor force participation rate. In political circles, there's a bit of a tug of war. Some talk about the unemployment rate dropping. Others say, oh my God, we're at 37-year lows on the labor force participation rate. What is your judgment as to what's behind the participation rate dropping? Is it structural? Is it people just kind of making informed decisions? What can we expect going forward? How important a benchmark can that be? And from a policy standpoint, is it something that policymakers should, in fact, focus on changing it in some fashion?
So I'll give you a very simple answer to a fairly complicated question, which is to say that based on demographic factors alone, there is an underlying declining trend, underlying structural declining trend in the labor force participation rate that predated the crisis and will continue. Now, on top of that, we saw a decline in the labor force participation rate that was associated with the Great Recession that was cyclical in nature. And researchers have been trying to parse that and to pull apart what of current movements in the labor force participation rate are simply structural from cyclical. My own reading is that as the labor force participation rate has stabilized somewhat over several labor force employment reports, that's a cyclical correction, that there is still a cyclical element of the depressed labor force participation rate. And again, that is one of the dimensions of slack that explains, perhaps, why wages are not tightening as one might expect at this point in the cycle. Again, that along with a very elevated number of workers who are not working as much as they would like, suggests that we have some distance to go.
Chuck, right down your second row. Put your hand up, Chuck, so you can see. There you go. Great.
Hello. Chuck Vollmer with Jobonomics. I think you're accurate in saying is that the unemployment rate, the labor force participation rate, the employment population ratios, I think they're just symptoms. It's our data. We believe that the structural issues are really tied to the not in the labor force category, which is 93 million able-bodied Americans now no longer work and are looking for work, and they were leaving the workforce at three times the rate that they're entering the workforce and the employed, because to be employed, you have to look for work. The other structural thing we think that is the contingent workforce. You mentioned part-timers, but part-timers are only a small part of that, especially with the millennial generation. A third of our workforce is contingent work now. And it's looking to go by 2030 to about 40% of the workforce. And if the millennials really act, or the Generation Z act on the way that they're culturally, it could be 50% of the workforce, which will be significant structural changes to the workforce. My question is, on the not in the labor force category, those able-bodied that can work, that don't work, and the contingent workforce growing, are those factors that you really look at?
So obviously, there's a set of underlying structural changes that are impacting the economy that I certainly think are important and try to keep abreast of the data and the research on that. And then there's a set of cyclical factors that is really more in our wheelhouse, if you will. And trying to disentangle that in the wake of an extraordinarily damaging crisis is unusually difficult. So we look at the data and their historical relationships for some set of signals about what's going on and what's the appropriate stance of monetary policy to support one leg of our dual mandate, which is full employment. To the extent that there are structural features that may be subject to other kinds of policy, obviously those are really not things that we would act on, but would need to understand. And I have put some special emphasis on trying to understand some of the particular challenges that may be facing the millennial generation, those workers who came of age at a time when the labor market was particularly difficult to penetrate and to navigate, and how that might affect their subsequent job trajectories, earning trajectories, as well as their investment decisions, their risk-taking, because I think that may be some that may be a legacy that is with us for some time.
We'll take this lady down in the second row. Thank you. And then I'll come back to you with the next question.
Thank you. My name is Liu Jie. I'm a reporter with China's Xinhua News Agency. My first question is about the U.S. economy. And recently, people are talking about a new normal of the U.S. economy, say, in the next 5 years or longer. The U.S. economy will grow at a very slow and a modest pace. So what's your interpretation of the new normal of the U.S. economy in the next 5 years or longer? And the second question is about the cross-border spillovers. As both the U.S. and the Chinese economy are undergoing significant structure changes, so what are the overlapping policy agenda for both countries in the longer run? Thank you.
So let me start with the second question first and say that, in fact, the U.S. is confronting a number of changes in the wake of its financial crisis, and China, too, is confronting challenges. I think China's challenges are, in some respects, even greater from a structural point of view, just given the very steep demographic profile that China faces in the years ahead, as well as the need to shift resources from more export resource-intensive big investment projects to making consumers really the engine of the economy. And that will take some time, but the reform agenda that has been articulated in China does go in that direction. But I would say there is a very important positive agenda for the U.S. And China. And in particular, you know, we've seen the very important beginnings of a rebalancing in both China and the U.S. To more sustainable patterns of growth. You know, we've seen a very large current account surplus in China from 10% at the peak, now coming down towards 2%. And on the U.S. side, we've seen a 6% deficit at its peak, which was unhealthy, coming down to 3%. You know, my hope is in the years ahead we don't see any reemergence of those imbalances, because I think it's important for the overall health of both economies going forward that we grow in a way that is more balanced. With regard to the U.S., obviously, again, I'm trying to disentangle what might be very temporary factors, what might be cyclical factors from underlying structural factors. And I think there is a debate about why productivity in the last very short period of time has seemed to diminish, and whether this is likely to be evidence of lower potential growth going forward. You know, I am not in the secular stagnation camp. I think we still have room to grow. And, you know, I hope we'll continue to provide support to the recovery to allow growth to improve in the U.S.
Okay, on the fourth row, yes, the lady right in the middle.
Hi, Nancy Jacklin. I have a question about the Fed's toolkit as you look toward a potential reversal of Fed policy and trying to execute that effectively. The Fed just announced a possible new tool for the toolkit as a way to either reduce reliance on reverse repos or supplement it. And I wonder if you could explain that tool to us and also what the Fed's concerns are with the use of reverse repo as a primary tool.
So I think as we have seen in the FOMC statements as well as in the principles of normalization, as liftoff is undertaken and normalization gets underway, the primary tool that the FOMC intends to continue to rely on will be the interest on excess reserves. Knowing that we're at an unusual period with a lot of excess reserves in the system, you know, we have a belts and suspenders kind of approach to normalization. And so we also have the facility, the overnight reverse repurchase facility, that will be used to help put a floor under the target range for the federal funds rate. And I think we have, we've had some testing, we have good confidence that that framework will be sufficient. To the extent that we need additional tools, we also have a variety of tools that have been tested. And so I think, you know, we're really getting prepared for any contingency, but based on the testing that we've undertaken so far, I think we have good confidence that we'll be able to see effective monetary control, good control over the federal funds rate as we lift off and begin the normalization process, with that primary reliance on the interest on excess reserves and a secondary use of the overnight reverse repurchase facility to help provide a floor.
Over here in the third row, I've got somebody. Let's do that. Depending, if we get the questions tight, we might get a few more in. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm Ben Carliner from the EU delegation. I was hoping that you could expand on your comments about the term premium a little bit, both in terms of what factors do you think have been driving movements in the term premium over the past year, and also in terms of how future developments are going to influence the Fed's policy normalization, in particular with regards to the evolution of the balance sheet.
So as I noted earlier, we have obviously been watching a whole array of financial market indicators. And one of the features that I think was noted by market participants and certainly was noted in our analysis as well is that we saw long-term yields falling, particularly following the actual advent of quantitative easing on the part of the ECB. That those movements in European bond markets seem to have pretty close spillovers into U.S. Bond markets, which was notable at a time when normalization is coming into clearer view here in the U.S. Now, subsequent to that time, we've seen some reversal, some increase in long-term yields, certainly in European bond markets and notably here in the U.S. When normalization arrives, I think, you know, we will, the members of the committee, you know, will be watching carefully to see what happens at the longer end of the yield curve. And as I stated earlier in my remarks, I don't think we can rule out that long-term yields could move, depending on underlying term premia, in either direction. And so we are very attentive to that.
Right down in the front here, they're growing, you're growing. I'm not sure we'll be able to get them all. Let's try.
Thank you. Thanks, John. Governor. Governor, you've mentioned growth a couple of times, and you've also mentioned that you're not sort of tied to a static sort of vision for America moving forward. Particularly with the issue of infrastructure, what role might it play in tying the economies of the world together, clearly creating job opportunities for workers who are a bit stagnant now? If you could offer some thoughts on that, please.
Well, I think the case for, you know, a both more performance-based and much more robust infrastructure investment agenda in the U.S. is overwhelming, both from a short-term growth perspective and from a longer-term growth, productivity and innovation perspective. And, you know, I think you probably know this better than anybody, but you go across different classes of infrastructure in the U.S., and generally we underperform many of our peers in the advanced economies and in some cases even in emerging markets. And that matters for long-term innovation, you know, whether it's moving ideas or moving people or moving goods to the places that they can be most innovative and most productive. You know, if we have aging infrastructure, unsafe infrastructure, infrastructure that's vulnerable, you know, that diminishes our potential as an economy. And it's a particularly attractive area. It's potentially an area that should attract bipartisan support, you know, both for more infrastructure funding, but also more performance-based infrastructure spending. And it's a, again, it's a agenda that both fits the short-term needs of the economy. It creates just the right kind of jobs and activity. It's well-suited for the current environment with a lot of, you know, sort of well-priced credit available. And it would also help with these productivity questions that are being raised. So, you know, I'm an advocate, but of course that is not a policy area that sits in any way with the Federal Reserve.
Lynn, I'm going to take you. I'm going to come down to this lady, and then we're going to wrap up.
Thank you. Governor Lynn Mattis, National Economic Security Grid. One of the things that we've seen take place is significant volatility in the markets, stock markets, a lot of driven by hedge funds that have attacked companies and really undermined their stability by trying to just draw more shareholder returns. And then we've seen activities involved with a big drive towards automated trading, which drives significant volatility. Could you give us your thoughts on both of those issues?
Yeah, so I will say that there have been a few episodes in recent months of sharp spikes in volatility and, you know, in some cases associated with big news, big policy news, in some cases really not associated with very obvious big drivers of news. And so, you know, we, as part of the work that we do on financial stability, are, you know, looking very carefully at what might be contributing to this more volatile or at least spikier set of events. And, you know, questions I think that have been raised and really do merit some more work, which we're working on, are questions about the change of market structure in some cases. And, you know, it clearly in some of these markets, and I can't, you know, it's very particular to the types of instruments being traded in the markets, but in some of these markets we do see, you know, a very notable shift in market structure to many more participants, more dominant part of the trading activity taking place with electronic trading, algorithmic trading, high frequency trading. And so, you know, it's important for us to understand how that might be affecting market functioning and market dynamics. And so we are spending some time on those questions. I think it's, you know, it's early days yet to draw firm conclusions.
We're going to take this lady right here at the end, and I'm sorry, folks, I've got about a half a dozen, but we're not going to be able to make it.
Governor, my name is Meredith Sumter, and I'm a consultant to U.S. companies abroad. I was struck by your comments on the younger generations, the millennials, the Gen X, et cetera. We have long been a consumer-driven economy, and coming of age with the dot-com bust in the late 90s, and then being an adult during the financial crisis of 08 and afterwards, I often wonder if this change in the way that these younger generations tend to make use of the resources, focusing on the balance sheet rather than spending, if this is something that is not temporal, but rather something that is more psychological, that will stay with us as we age and go through life. And in that circumstance then, how should we think about the future growth of our economy? How should we consider growing our economy if we will continue to not consume or spend as much as our predecessors?
So So those are really important and good questions, and I really have very partial answers to them. You know, there has been some research that's been done that I've alluded to previously that suggests that the Great Depression generation did have some lasting effects in terms of views about the riskiness of certain kinds of investments or activities, for instance. And I think it's, you know, it's just a question today as to whether we might see some persistent effects on the Great Recession generation. What we do know are the conditions that they confronted, you know, as they graduated from high school or graduated from college or were going into their first, second, third jobs. And what we know is that unemployment rates that they confronted, particularly in their age groups, were sky high. That earnings potential was lower than it had been pre-crisis. You know, for many jobs that were posted, either experience or education requirements were elevated relative to what they would have been pre-crisis. So this is some of the things we know. We also know that the Great Recession generation chose in, you know, sort of surveying these rather dismal job prospects to get more education, that more of this education was financed through student loans than had previously been the case, that for many people that's going to turn out to be a very good investment, but for some people they either didn't complete their degree or they took on debt to finance programs that haven't panned out in terms of better labor market outcomes, and so they're going into their kind of young adult decisions about housing and when to start families with greater debt burdens than they might otherwise have done. We do know that household formation, you know, has been extremely delayed for this group. So, you know, many of you perhaps are either living with your parents or maybe have your kids still living with you. For the record, in my case, I would be delighted for my kids to stay as long as possible, but I don't think that's universally true. And of course, this delay in household formation is also being seen in depressed home ownership rates for this generation. And, you know, there too, not only are many of our young people carrying student loan burdens that may make it more difficult for them to make that first, you know, sort of mortgage, but also they may have a different view about how beneficial a home investment is likely to be, given that they might have experienced through their parents' eyes mortgages that became albatrosses and housing investments that didn't turn out quite the way they expected, even though we know from research that home ownership still, despite even with all the data from the financial crisis, is still perhaps the best investment that many middle-class Americans can make.
This has been a remarkably informative seminar. It's been a learning for me. And so I just would like to say thank you to you, Dr. Brainard. It's been a fabulous insight into your job, your thoughts, how you're looking at the world and our world. And I think you've made all of us better and more informed. Thank you. Would you all please thank her?